Okay, so this is the first one, and then what?
And then 693.
693?
92.
92, okay. Oh, God will take care of you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Yep, okay. Yeah, no, this is easy, because it's in G, so that's, yeah.
I remember, I took a couple years of piano, of death and all.
Oh, okay.
Distributed death and event, all the flats and everything.
Yeah, and the flat, you know, it's really funny, and I don't know really what the difference is, because they're the same keys, but it's harps usually that throw pianos.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like, you could see four or five flats, and it's okay, but if you see four or five sharps, oh, man. That's a lot harder. I don't know why, because it's still flat keys, but for whatever reason, and everyone I know is like that. Like, you, a lot of people will actually change code that into flats, so they don't have to do it, you know? So I've done that too, I'm like, oh, I'm not playing at that key. I'm a wimp, sorry. Yeah, that's right.
Amen. Good evening. Welcome to Faith Baptist Church, our Wednesday evening service, the 16th of September, the year of our Lord 2020. Amen. Let's all stand right there. Let's sing some praise this evening, get our hearts and minds aligned for the Word of God tonight. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Amen. Let's remember His name alone is excellent. Amen. Let's sing it out. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown Him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown Him Lord of all. Aren't you glad He's Lord of all tonight? Sing that third verse now. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball to Him all majesty ascribe and crown Him Lord of all. To Him all majesty ascribe and crown Him Lord of all. Amen. That's good singing. Keep it up now. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at His feet may fall. We'll join the everlasting song and crown Him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown Him Lord of all. Amen. Are you glad you're saved tonight? Amen. Let's turn to page 692. I just have to say that. Doesn't that sound great? That was almost like old times. I'll turn to page 692. God will take care of you. The first time I heard this song, a missionary wife had sung it. So precious. Let's take it with us throughout the week. Amen. Verse 1. Be not dismayed. Be not dismayed. Whate'er betide, God will take care of you. Beneath His wings of love abide. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. Amen. A third verse. All you may need, he will provide. God will take care of you. Nothing you ask will be denied. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Be not dismayed. He'll lead the way. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Amen. I make the mistake every now and then trying to look at the screen and look at my book. I think we missed a verse there. So I appreciate your patience. I didn't expect a solo, but all right. One last verse. One last verse to sound it out tonight. Let's sing it like we want California to hear it. Amen. Last verse now. No matter what may be the test. Amen. We got the verse up there. Let's sing it out now. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. What do we do? Lean weary one upon his breast. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Be not dismayed or all the way. Amen. Got it now. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. Amen. Why don't we open here with a word of prayer tonight? Amen. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we're so thankful that your name alone is excellent. And Lord, we can just trust in you because you'll take care of us, meeting every need. And Lord, every need represented here tonight, we already know, Lord, you're there. And you're carrying more than we can, and you'll take care of us, Lord, in your perfect will and way. We're thankful for this tonight. Pray for those that were not able to be with us, Lord, this evening. We just ask your blessings now on those young people, the folks in other classes, Lord, tonight. And we just pray now you'll bless us here, even in this hour. Encourage our pastor as we bring forth the word of God. Help us to be praying for one another during our time of prayer. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
All right. Thanks, Beth, for playing and for John for leading. That's a great song. God will take care of you no matter what. All right. We'll look at our prayer list. And you'll see a couple. I think there are one on each side in just a moment. The prayer guide. And they are... Okay, so one to add to this is Joan McNally is having her infusion tomorrow, and so it's where it's a 2 or 3 hour procedure. She has that every 2 or 3 months, so she stayed home tonight to get ready for that infusion tomorrow, so pray for Joan. Patty Chapel was taken into emergency, having some problems there, and she is coming home today. Hopefully she's home now. Didn't have to do any surgery and giving her medicine, so continue to pray for Patty. And then I remember Missy and Kelton's family is, her father, Robert Andrews, is nearing death. It could be within any day now, and so he's not eating anymore, and just remember family, especially in prayer, Robert Andrews. Michelle, and this is Carol's daughter, and she had the COVID test today, and she doesn't know anything yet. It takes 3 to 5 days. She's being quarantined. Okay. So pray for Michelle. John Willis is doing well at home. Hopefully he'll be able to be back with us soon. And then Don Hoover cut his hand a few days ago, and he will need some hand surgery in the future. And then the Hoovers granddaughter Robin is home from the hospital and receiving counseling. So pray for Don and also Robin. And then there's a fellow that has just come the last maybe 3 weeks, lives not far from the church, and he sits back here. His name is Ken, an older gentleman, and I'm not sure if his last name is correct or not, but he talked to me Sunday and said he was having a stent put in. He said, this will be my fifth stent to be put in this week. I believe he said Henry Ford, so I don't know what day for sure, but remember, I believe his name is Ken Long, Kenneth. And then we've been praying for the Boston son-in-law, Dan, with Parkinson's disease and also receiving hospice care. Tina and Jack are both having surgeries at the end of the month here, so remember them in prayer, the Hillies. And then Barbara and Willie Villar's son-in-law, Ray, had open-heart surgery. I believe it was yesterday, Tuesday. And so just remember him in prayer as he recovers. And then continue to remember Nancy McDonald's son with Parkinson's disease and also for her grandson, Sean. A couple of notes of our missionaries. Don't know if they are up there or not, but I'll go ahead and give them to you. You know Danny Jones and Michelle Jones? His wife has been very sick, and they thought she had COVID 19, but she doesn't, but she has a super bacteria, and it is brought severe pneumonia to her, and also she has chronic coughing. So she would have probably been in the hospital during this time, except for all of what's going on, but she has to go in for 5 days of treatment in the doctor's office to try to get better. So remember Michelle Jones, our missionary. And then Melissa Houston, another missionary here, has had surgery, and she's home recovering. And then also our missionary son, McKinney, to the Indians out west, son Benjamin, his family, his wife Anna, and son Caleb and daughter Tawny are positive for this virus. Then let me add a few others here. I think they may be up there. There's Randy Sutton. Talked to him, and he's been quite discouraged. Remember Brother Randy, especially in prayer, and he's been going through his treatments for 10 years. That's a long time to be dealing with his issue. He had a bronchial scope a week ago, and he was hoping to find out some results today, but he's going to have to wait on that. And he told me that he's been having a lot of pain in his left side, all up and down this whole left side of his body, and then he's having a very difficult time breathing. And he's praying that the cancer is not in his lungs. So continue to remember him in prayer. And then Tom Hoover has another, he's with us here tonight, and has another brain tumor they found, and it's about as big as the end of your finger. But so pray for him as they go through the procedure and steps to help him with that. Let me add another one here. And a couple of weeks we're having evangelist Alan Harris. We've had him here a few years ago, a couple of times. He sings and preaches. I went to school with him and sang in a quartet with him so many years ago in college. But he texted me today and said that this Hurricane Sally, I believe is the name of it, was headed straight into their house, that in the vicinity of their home. And he said that they've lost their power, no water, patio roof blew off, tree down in the backyard, shingles blown off, flashing torn off the house, and leaks. So he's kind of overwhelmed with that right now. So remember him in prayer. He will be with us on the 27th in both morning services there. Let's see what else here. October the 4th, that's three Sundays away, we're going to at our Sunday evening service again at 5 p.m., and then that morning, starting October the 4th at 11, we're going to have some classes for our children at 11 during the 11 o'clock hour from, I believe it's the toddlers up through the sixth grade. So we're going to add that and then add the service both on October the 4th. Then our mission conference is coming up, and that is October the 16th, 17th, and 18th. We'll have three missionaries here, and we have it from Wednesday to Sunday, but this year it's just from Monday through Sunday. So a few things going on. Everybody awake and happy in the Lord? I hope so. Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, I do pray for Joan as she has her procedure tomorrow. May that go well. Lord, for Patty as she's recovering and then also having her test and possible surgery for her other neck problem. And then, Lord, for Michelle, I pray for her as she's waiting the results and quarantined for a few days. Lord, for John as he's recovering from his procedure, and for Don, who needs the surgery sometime on his hand to help straighten out his finger there from this accident. And then, Lord, I pray for their granddaughter, Robin, as she's having issues and has been in the hospital, and just bless her in a special way. Lord, for this visitor we've had, and he's been faithful to come the last few weeks, Ken, I pray for him as he's having another stent put in, that he would be able to recover from that in good fashion. Lord, for Dan, who's in hospice with the Parkinson's disease, and for those taking care of him, for Jack and Tina both with upcoming surgeries, that you'll bless them. May those surgeries go well and correct the problem. And for the Villars' son-in-law, Ray, who just had open-heart surgery yesterday. And, Lord, I understand how that is, having been through that. And so, Lord, give him recovery of his health as he goes through therapy, I'm sure, and rehab, that he would be back on his feet and walking. And Lord, he would be well, I pray. For McDonald's son, who has the Parkinson's disease, and also for their grandson, Sean, I pray for him that the things he's going through would be corrected and that he would get back on track. Lord, for these three missionaries we have, for Michelle and for Melissa and for the whole McKinney family, that, Lord, even though they are in different places, far from us, serving you, that you'll take care of them there. Lord, we know that distance is no hindrance to our prayers, and so we pray for them in a special way. And for Brother Randy, Lord, who's going through pain right now and trying to figure out what the next step is, I pray for him. And for Tom also with the tumor, that they'd be able to get that dissolved and corrected. Lord, we thank you for the praise here that I did not mention Mary Jo's brother, who's doing better and is there with them now in the hotel as they take care of him. Lord, for Brother Allen, I pray for him as he is trying to get his house back in order and also coming to be with us in just a couple of weeks, that he would be a blessing as he sings and preaches. Lord, for all the things that are coming up, for our missions conference, as we reopen Sunday night and bring some children here for classes to be taught your word. Lord, it's been very difficult over the last several months. And so, Lord, may things get better in our country, in our state, in our city, and that we would be able to completely open up soon of all the things and get back to a normal situation. Lord, be with us now as we open your word again to a chapter that many may just skip over. And Lord, may we gain some principles from this chapter, chapter 7 in Nehemiah tonight, that would, Lord, honor you and bless us in a special way. I pray in Jesus' name and for his sake and with thanksgiving. Amen. Okay, Nehemiah, chapter 7. And we might wonder why the Lord puts a genealogy here in this chapter that's very similar, just about the same as another genealogical record over in the book of Ezra, chapter 2. They're very, very similar. So why would the Lord take time to list a whole bunch of names? And sometimes in the Chronicles and different places, we may have the tendency just to skip right over all of that. But people are important to the Lord. Every person here tonight that are gathered in this church, those that are watching, are important. And so here, chapter 7 is a pivotal chapter. It is in the middle of the 13 chapters in Nehemiah. You have 6 chapters that deal with the building, the rebuilding of the structure of the wall and the gates of the city of Jerusalem. So the first 6 chapters, and now it's all been completed. Then we have chapter 7, and then we have 6 more chapters afterwards. But the chapter 7 lies in the middle. The last 6 chapters do not deal with the building. That's already completed. Well, isn't the building the most important thing? No. The people. The building is not the church. The church are the people, the assembling of God's children together. And so now, Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah, will deal with not the building of the walls, but the building of the people. Not the physical labor, but the spiritual work. I've been thinking here lately about the past 5 years, and about way back when the Lord laid on my heart to build a new building and things, and it's been very difficult. And Nehemiah was able to do his project in 52 days. Boy, I wish that would have only taken 52 days to get this building completed. It wasn't even 52 weeks. It was longer than that. But I'm sure that Nehemiah was glad it was over with. Of course, he had the people themselves doing the work. And we were going to do some of the work ourselves. I hope you know maybe that was in the plan. We were going to gather a bunch of people up, and we were going to paint. And I used to do some painting. Of course, Dave would have been a supervisor here. But then I had the heart attack, and I'm right before we were supposed to start painting. Aren't you glad I had that heart attack? No. But I'm there in the hospital, and Brother Dan and Brother Mike, they came by and there to see me. I think Brother Randy and Dan says, you know, and Dan doesn't know how to paint very well. He'll admit to it, and he says, I don't think we can get this done. And so we went ahead and just incorporated the cost of that into the building project. But a lot of work. The people built the walls, and they listened and followed the direction of Nehemiah to get a great project done. So the first 6 chapters, the wall was the focus. Building the wall around the city of Jerusalem. The last six chapters deal with worship. Well, we've built this place here, had it built, and now we are in here worshiping. I can remember when, and how many of you remember when we wrote verses out on the steel beams out, and that's all was here? We put prayer requests and scriptures, and I took pictures of all those. I have those somewhere. So the building is not everything. It's what we do now in building the kingdom of God and building each other up in the admonition of God. No building project should ever take precedence over the church, the people. We just finished a project that Brother Randy and Brother Paul Fallis and Frank Nowitzki and others have come up here and helped us. A lot of times you look around and you see things that just kind of happen, and you think, oh, boy, that must have been easy. Oh, wow, look at what they've done there. Well, they spent a couple of weeks, solid weeks, tearing out walls in the gymnasium to put 4x6 beams and part of it all the way to the ceiling inside there, like 20-something, about 20 feet tall, and then putting extra braces in there in metal plates so that we could put our basketball goals, which weighed a couple of hundred pounds, so they didn't fall down and hurt somebody. So they, you could hang on those now and just live up there, and they'd never come down. But we wanted to make sure that they were safe. And so we put those up, we patched the walls up and painted it, and now, but we have a couple of more things to do. And that, all of that cost us quite a bit of money to get all of that done. And now we have to stripe the gym floor, which about a year or so ago when the floor was put down, I was given a quote of about $3,000 to put the certain paint and get it all done and to stripe the floors to play. And then we have to put padding on the walls underneath the gold. It's going to cost about $1,000 just to put about 12 pads underneath those basketball goals. So there we're looking at about $4,000. So if anybody has a little extra money for the building project that was almost completed, let me know. And this Nehemiah would appreciate it. We still have our rock. You remember the rock, the big rock. It's being stored for us, but it weighs a ton, and we'll probably eventually put that out here toward the front in one of those islands somewhere, but it's getting close to being finished. There's always seemingly something to do, and so the building project, I'm sure Nehemiah was rejoicing. I remember when we first had our service here, and I was just so, it was just like, you know, it's a great thing to celebrate and to praise the Lord for what He does in our church and in our lives. We are here to glorify Jesus. We're here to win souls. We're here to invest in the kingdom of God. Nehemiah 7, let's look at it. Nehemiah 7, 1. Now it came to pass, and I'm sure Nehemiah was glad it came to pass, when the wall was built, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And he says, and I had set up the doors. And he didn't really do this himself. He was watching over and administrating the placing of the doors and so forth. And you know, we also had it in the plans back to this building here. I believe there are 95 doors in this church. Can you believe that? And almost 100 doors, and we were contemplating maybe putting those in ourselves. Oh, I'm so glad we didn't get into that. Wow. To try to save some money, but we went ahead and had them do it. And so a lot of doors. They had all the doors set up. He had it. he appointed people to do that. And the porters, which were those that would stand by the doors and keep watch over the entrance ways to the city, and the singers, the choir, the worship team, the special singing, they were getting that ready. And the Levites, those that would be the helpers of the priests, it says, were appointed. They were getting things ready now that the city was fortified on the outside to get ready to worship God. I can't wait till our choir can meet again and get ready and we can utilize them and praise the Lord. Getting ready, they were getting Nehemiah, getting the people ready to sing. And it was very important. And they called Kathy in to help them. No. It's something very interesting here because notice in chapter 7, they were preparing to sing, and in chapter 8, revival takes place. So God does use music, and it's very important. Then they called Alden in. I mean, they called the porters in. The gatekeepers, the watchers of the doors. And they were also involved in music in the scripture. And then they got the Levites all ready to help the priests in worshiping God. Verse 2, he says that I gave my brother Hananiah, the ruler of the palace, or actually the ruler of the city of Jerusalem is what he's talking about there, charge over Jerusalem, for he was a faithful man and feared God above many. So Nehemiah had been there, and he was going to start relinquishing some of the authority. And so he chose two men that he could really have confidence in, who were qualified to carry on as he would go back to Persia and make trips back and forth. He couldn't be there all the time, and so he starts delegating his authority to people he could trust. There needed to be somebody there to help watch over what he had built. He wasn't just going to have it left and then leave. And so he noticed in verse 2, he gave charge. He gave, and then it says later on in that passage that he gave charge to one of his relatives, Hanani, the person that came to him in the very beginning, you'll recall, back in chapter 1, and told him about the situation there in Jerusalem and how bad the city was, and it was just a shame. And so this was his relative, it says here his brother, and he trusted him. And then there's another fellow here, almost with the same name, Hananiah. Notice there are two things that the Bible says were very important about this man, Hananiah. Now, not everybody is called to preach or teach or to sing, and not everybody can do all of those things, but you know what? There are a couple of things that everybody can do. What does this verse say? What's the first quality? Faithfulness. It actually means to be full of faith, to be dependable. Nehemiah was looking for somebody. He didn't look for the most talented. He looked for the person who was close to God, spiritual. These two men happened to be one of his relatives, and then the other fellow here who was already in a position over there, over in a high position that was helping him out already. He'd already proven himself. But of Hananiah, notice what it says about him. He was a faithful man. Wonder what somebody would say about your life. Would they say you're a faithful person? Are you faithful to church? Are you faithful to God? Are you faithful to your family? Are you faithful in your service to God? Are you faithful in your tithing and giving and faithful in your helping other people and faithful in sharing the Word of God with somebody? How faithful are we? Faithfulness is so important. I would rather have somebody in church that's faithful that I can count on than anything else. You can have all kinds of abilities, and yet the most important ability is dependability. To stay by the stuff. Faithfulness is so important. I wonder how many of y'all see if I'm still around in 5 years from now. Will you still be in the house of God, serving God? Will you still be praising the Lord and reading your Bible and doing what God wants you to do? Faithfulness, no matter what comes our way. Because we have a faithful God. Great is His faithfulness. He wants us to be faithful. Now, if you're not faithful, it means you're just, you know, you can't be counted on. I mean, you're here, you're there, you know, you never know what you'll be doing. But someone who has stickability, dependable, faithful, spiritual, you can rely on them. You can count on them. They're always there to do whatever's needed. Well, this was the quality of this man, Hananiah. The Bible says, he that's faithful in a few things, God will make you ruler over many things. If you're faithful in the small things, God will give you greater things to be a servant in one day. God rewards us according to our faithfulness. The Bible, one of my favorite verses says, a faithful man aboundeth with blessings. Faithful person. I wonder if when God looks down upon us right now, who he sees that's filled with faith and trusting God. Then he was a man who feared God. He is a man of reverence and respect for Almighty God. Faithful in what he did and faithful to the Lord and in respecting God. He was reverent. He was responsible and he was reverent. He was faithful and he feared. And then notice it says above many. That means he stood out up against most of the people. He was in God's vision of being a man who feared God and he was faithful. So circle this verse too. This is a very, very important verse that we have. Nehemiah wanted somebody who would be faithful when he was not there. Someone who could lead the people spiritually. After physical building was done, it was time for spiritual building. Verse 3, he says, and I said unto them, let not the gates of Jerusalem be opened until the sun be hot. When is the sun usually the hottest? In the early morning hours? No. Here lately, you get up early and it's a little cool. You feel that, you know, the fall in the air. And then maybe around noon, 1 o'clock, it starts heating up a little bit. So he says, don't open the gates of the city. And so those porters, those people who were at the gates, were important. Don't open them until the sun be hot. And while they stand by, let them shut the doors and bar them. And appoint watches of the inhabitants of Jerusalem, everyone in his watch, to guard and watch different times, taking turns, and everyone to be over against his house, to watch out for the enemies coming in and going out of the city. So there was a call for public safety. There was a need for protection against any outside forces that might come. The city was to be kept shut until everyone was awake and alert. No opening of the gates early in the morning at sunrise. No, that wasn't to happen. They were to be opened late and then closed early for the people's protection. Let me just say something. I'm not going to get political, but the security of a nation is always a top priority. Enough said there. Verse 4. Then he tells about another situation. He says, now the city was large. A few miles around it on the outside. And it was great, or of a city of importance. And now that the gates and the doors and the walls had all been fixed, all the holes in the walls have been plugged up, he said, okay, we have a city now. But what was the problem? But the people were few that were in it. There was nobody really living in the city much. And why were they not living in the city? Why? Some of them had come back. We'll talk about that in a moment. But they weren't. Would you like to live in a city that's torn down and burned with fire? And then it says, and the houses were not builded. They fall down. Their shacks are boarded up. It would be like Detroit especially a few years ago, and going through there, all these boarded up houses and stuff. And who wants to live there? Well, they came back. They were living outside the city. It was not a secured city. It was broken down, and the houses were all in shambles. There were shacks everywhere, boarded up things. They'd built the walls, but to live in the city inside, they weren't ready to go there yet. And so you had a place, but you had no people, basically. That was a concern for Nehemiah. He envisioned the place filled with people. People are important in this chapter. That's why it's focused on individuals. Well, not everyone of Israel, when they had an opportunity to return, when Cyrus, the king of Persia, allowed them to come back starting in 536 B.C., not everybody wanted to come back. Now, why would they not want to go back to Jerusalem? Anybody have any idea? Why would they not all want to return? A lot of them probably got comfortable in Babylon. The city of Babylon was beautiful. One of the seven wonders of the world at that time. They got used to where they were. Okay, what would be another reason they might not have returned? Prospering. Some of them probably had their places that they'd gotten situated in society, and they didn't want to leave that. Anybody else? Now, what? Well, they could have taken their families with them, but yeah, that might have, could have caused a problem if some wanted to leave and some didn't want to leave. Sure. What else could have caused a problem? Yes. Okay, they might have had to, that could have happened. They go back, then they'd have to maybe go back to worshiping God and doing things like that. That could have happened. Now, we have to remember that it was about 800 miles or more. Not everybody wanted to make that long journey. 800 miles today is a little bit of a distance in our day and time, can you imagine making that journey? Actually, it took them, I believe under the leadership of Ezra, took them 4 months to make that journey, some of them. He would take about a couple of thousand men back when in the second deportation. What about the sick people, the older people, to make that long journey? And then there were some that had never even lived in Jerusalem to begin with, because 70 years, some had grown up just in Babylon. And so, you know, so to make a long story short here, they didn't all return. About 50,000 of them came back in under the leadership of the governor Zerubbabel, the first deportation from Babylon. About somewhere around 50,000 made their way back, but they didn't all go in the city. They were scattered around, and over time, over 100 to 150 years, people had grown up around the outside of the city, and so there are a few hundred thousand people there by now. And Nehemiah says, man, we got to get the people back in. Now, Nehemiah had prayed, you remember in chapter 1. He had sought God's wisdom. He had fasted. He had waited upon God. Now that his task is complete, you still find Nehemiah praying to God. He was a man that was close to the Lord. And he would speak to God, and God would speak to him. Notice this next verse 5. This is really an important verse to zero in on. Look what he says here. He says, and God, my God. You see, he had a relationship with God. He didn't get just caught up in this building project and forget about the Lord. And many times that can happen. You can get so focused on doing all the things, and yet you don't keep your heart open to God. He says, my God put what? Into, or where? Into mine heart. I wonder what God has put into your heart lately, in my heart. He says, God put in my heart. He was a man who opened his heart to the Lord, and God would fill his heart, and God would direct him, speak to him. So what has God, here's the question, what has God put into your heart lately? Think about that for a moment. He says, God put in my heart to gather together the nobles and the rulers and the people. For what reason would he gather them together? That they might be reckoned by genealogy. He says, let's find out who's here and where you're from, what tribe you are, you know, you're from, and all these things. So He wanted to take a survey and find out who he's dealing with, just like he had first gone to the city of Jerusalem and surveyed it and looked, tried to see the situation. He wanted to see, okay, who do I have? Who am I dealing with? Who's on the outskirts of the city, and how many people can we get in? And so they tried to find out who everybody was by their genealogy, their genealogical record. And he says, and I found a register. I found a register of the genealogy of who? Them which came up at the first, that first deportation. When they were first allowed to return, that had been about 100 and over 100 years. They found it. They found the record. And he says, and found written therein. So they looked through the register, census, you might say, that was taken back when the people had first been allowed to return. He used this located list, he was going to use it, to remind the people who they were, their personal identity, their national identity as people of Israel, and then for those who would get busy working in their certain areas. Those who were supposed to be priests would be the priests. Those who were from the tribe of Levi, those who were the Levites would get in their place. So he wanted to make sure everything was worked out and that it was organized so they can get busy serving God and doing their responsibilities. So they checked their genealogy on Ancestry.com. Anybody done that? Come on, some of you have. My daughter Melanie checked her DNA genetics the other day, and so she sent me, my wife and I, this list of telling what we're all made of, where we came from. And it said that we are 35% English from England, 30% Scottish, 12% German, 9% Irish, 2% French, 6% Wales, 4% Swedish, and 1% from some area in India. So basically, my DNA says that I'm, I guess you might say, 90-something percent European, mainly English and Scottish and Irish. I kind of fought that. My mother's maiden name is McManus, which over in Ireland, that's a common name. And then Bedwell is an English and Scottish name. In fact, researching my ancestry, there was a William Bedwell. Well, let me back up. I had some bad ancestors, too. I had some that were bandits and robbers. They were called the Bedwell brothers, and they were like Jesse James and, all of those. Well, anyway, you can go down, I think it's Alabama, and find stuff about the Bedwell brothers. But anyway, but there's a good one. I'll just end with that one. His name was William Bedwell, and he was one of the translators of the King James Bible. In fact, he helped translate the first 12 books of the Old Testament. He was an expert in linguistics and the language of of Hebrew and Arabic and the Mediterranean languages. So anyway, English and Scottish primarily. So he tried to find out what tribe these people were from. Verse 6 says this. It says in verse 6, these are the children of the province that went up, notice, out of the captivity when they were released from Babylon to return. Of those that had been carried away, that's the 70-year captivity, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away. And that was over 100 years. Almost 150 years prior, and they found this record. And came again to Jerusalem and to Judah, everyone unto his city. They congregated and lived in all the different cities around the outside of Jerusalem. I don't ever recall being asked to fill out a census report more than my whole life than this year. I don't know about you, but I've gotten about 15 of them in the mail. We had someone knock on our door the other day wanting to know information and coming and phone calls, and so census taking. Want to know some information about you. He was taking the census, you might say, and refiguring everything, trying to figure out who was around him so that he could bring some of the people from the countryside back into the city and also help in qualifying who were to be the Levites and the priests, as they would have to reestablish the worship of God. The registry that they found revealed 42,360 Jews, 7,337 servants, and 245 singers, all of those who were a part of coming back under the leadership of the governor Zerubbabel. This was back in 536 B.C., which, if you total it up, would have been around real close to 50,000 people. But really, that was only about 2% of all the people that were not in the city. There were a lot of people that did not return. And then, as I said, about 547 B.C., after that, some came back under the leadership of Ezra. 4,289 priests were written down that came back. 148 singers, and those were the ones who were the descendants of Asaph, the musician. Well, look in verse, jump all the way down now over these genealogies to verse 67. Beside their manservants and their maidservants, of whom there were 7,337, and they had 245 singing men and singing women. Men and women who were singing together the praises of the Lord, again, is mentioned here in the record. 138 porters, or those that would guard the doors. And then they added more later on, and there ended up being around 172 of them, keepers of the doors. Now jump over to Nehemiah 11, verse 19. It says this, we have to hurry up here. Nehemiah 11, 19. Moreover, the porters, here's a couple of the guys' names. Akub, Talmon, and their brethren that kept the gates were 172. Can you imagine this conversation? Hey, Akub and Talmon, what have you been doing in your life to advance the kingdom of God? Well, we stand by the gates. We open them and shut them. Oh, okay. Wow. But that was important. These were important positions for the security of the city. I wonder what you do for the Lord. Is anything that you're doing not important? No. We all have our places doing what God wants us to do. Verse 60. There were people called the Nethinims. That's a strange name. All the Nethinims and the children of Solomon's servants were 392. These were the servants and the helpers of the Levites. The Levites would help the priests, but these Nethinims helped the Levites, servants. So they found out how many of those workers there were. And then verse 61 says, and there were they which went up also from Telmelah, Telharesha, Cherub, Adon, and Emer. And so they tried to find their names written and tried to find where they were from and so forth, but notice what it says. But they could not show their father's house, nor their seed, whether they were of Israel. And so Nehemiah had them try to find proof that they were in line to be priests, because you were not supposed to be in the priesthood if you weren't from a descendant from Aaron. So they tried to check it out and find if they were, and they couldn't find it. They couldn't prove it, and then they were disqualified from being in that position. They had to give proof to be a priest. Aaronic ancestry. Well, let me just throw in an added thought here. Make sure that there's proof that your name is found written in a certain book. You know what that book is? The Lamb's Book of Life. It's an old song that says, is your name written there? Is your name written there? Oh, you want to be in that white robe choir. Is your name written there? When the roll is called up yonder, I hope you'll be there, your name, so you'll have access to the heavenly city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven. Some scholars have estimated there might have been several hundred thousand people outside the city, even maybe as much as 1 million people. So Nehemiah tried two ways to get the people back into the city. First, they cast lots. You might say they had to enter into a draft. And so about 100, maybe 100,000 possibly were chosen to move back into the city, 10%. And then there were some that just volunteered to go. They said, we'll go, we'll move. We'll pick up and go back into the city. Look at verses chapter 11, verses 1 and 2 as we come to a close. Chapter 11, verses 1 and 2. And the rulers of the people dwelt at Jerusalem, and the rest of the people also cast lots to bring one of 10, that's 10%, to dwell in Jerusalem, the holy city, and 90% to dwell in the other cities. And notice verse 2, and the people blessed all the men, what men? That willingly offered themselves to dwell at Jerusalem. Some people said, I know it's a big deal. We'll just pack up. We'll get rid of our house, and we'll go, we'll build again. We'll go in the city. So they willingly volunteered to help Nehemiah out, and it says they were glad. They blessed these people because they were willing in and of themselves. Now go back very quickly. And I want to end with a couple of notes here. Nehemiah 7, verse 70 says, and some of the chief of the fathers gave unto the work. So they needed to give. Sacrifice. The Tirshatha. What in the world is that? The Tirshatha. It's actually referred to Nehemiah as the Tirshatha, or the governor, the head official of Jerusalem. He gave. He gave the treasure. He gave into the treasure there 1,000 drams, which were Persian coins of gold, and then 50 basins or bowls, 530 priest garments. And so Nehemiah himself was responsible of bringing all that into the treasury of the city. All the people began to chip in, even those high officials. They gave gold and silver and priestly garments. And then the rest of the people gave too. So they all had a part in the work of God. Let's stand this evening as we close. What an important chapter. Easy to look over it, but a lot of principles throughout there of how that they got prepared to worship God. They found out who they were, where they belonged, and they gave, and they got ready. They got all the singers ready to worship God. Chapter 8 is a fantastic chapter filled with revival and worship, but there was preparation made before that would happen. Wonder what preparation we've made. Make sure your name's where it should be. Make sure you're busy serving God. Make sure you're ready to worship God, that you're faithful, that you fear God, and you're a part of of the family of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. We've been able to glean some principles from this chapter in the middle of the book. Lord, it just goes to show us that names are important, people are important to be recorded here in Scripture. Lord, help us to be doing our part to fill the house of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Send a great revival in my soul. Send a great revival in my soul. Let the Holy Spirit come and take control. And send a great revival in my soul. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
Tremble defenseless before the great I am.